Good morning. We greet you in the name of Christ, and today is the day we celebrate the Reformation. So you can see we've got all the chancel decorated in red, and we've got the Mighty Fortress banner up. And although we celebrate Christ above all, we are also glad for people like Martin Luther and other reformers who brought the gospel of Jesus back to people. So our service begins with the singing of the first hymn, the first two verses of A Mighty Fortress. We'll sing the second two verses before the sermon. But we stand when we sing A Mighty Fortress. The invocation. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us then confess our sins to God, our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not agreed with all our heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. To those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives the power to become the children of God and bestows on them the Holy Spirit. May the Lord, who has begun this good work in us, bring it to completion in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Our psalm today is from Psalm 46. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth gives way, though the mountains be moved into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble at its swelling. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. God of Jacob is our fortress. We sing a hymn of praise. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray together. We give thanks to you, Heavenly Father, through Jesus Christ, your dear Son, that you have kept us this night from all harm and danger. And we pray that you would keep us this day also from sin and every evil, that all our doings and life may please you. For into your hands we commend ourselves, our bodies and souls, and all that is ours. Let your holy angels be with us, that the evil foe may have no power over us. Amen. You may be seated for the readings.
Testament reading for today comes from Revelation chapter 14, verses 6 and 7. Then I saw another angel flying directly overhead with an eternal gospel to proclaim to those who dwell on earth, to every nation and tribe and language and people. And he said with a loud voice, "Fear God and give him glory, because the hour of his judgment has come. And worship him who made heaven and earth, the sea and the springs of water." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our epistle reading is from Romans chapter 3, verses 19 to 24. Now we know that whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be stopped, and the whole world may be held accountable to God. For by works of the law, no human being will be justified in his sight, since through the law comes knowledge of sin. But now the righteousness of God has been manifested apart from the law, although the law and the prophets bear witness to it. The righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. For there is no distinction, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and are justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Please stand for the reading of the Holy Gospel. Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 8th chapter. So Jesus said to the Jews who had believed in him, "If you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." They answered him, "We are offspring of Abraham and have never been enslaved to anyone. How is it that you say you will become free?" Jesus answered them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, everyone who commits sin is a slave to sin. The slave does not remain in the house forever. The Son remains forever. So if the Son sets you free, you will be free indeed." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. And it's children's sermon time. I get to bring out my statue of Martin Luther. So, boys and girls, wherever you are, this is not a statue of Jesus, okay? This is Luther. But I just want to say one thing important about what he's doing. Well, two things, really. One, we're a Lutheran church. We're named after this guy. He lived in the 1500s, and we always celebrate what he did in bringing the gospel back. But in this statue, he has his hand on something, and you maybe can't tell what that is, but it's the Bible. For Luther, the Word of God that talks about God's love for us was so important. And in his day, people had kind of stopped looking and reading the Bible, so it was really important to him. And we today also find that God's Word is really, really important. And Jesus says, "Make your home in my word." And we do that every time we read Bible stories, every time we think about what Jesus has done, because Jesus is the Word made flesh. So anyway, on Reformation Sunday, I wanted to bring up my little statue of Martin Luther. By the way, if you ever come in my office, I've got Luther bobbleheads. I've got a frisbee with Luther's seal on it. I've got more Luther stuff than you can shake a stick at. But today, the statue is what you get to see. All right, we continue with the sermon hymn, verses 3 and 4 of A Mighty Fortress. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. The sermon text is the gospel reading, which has already been read from John chapter 8. And in that particular reading, Jesus says, if you abide in my word, and maybe a better translation is, if you make your home in my word, you will be my disciples. Well, all I can say is we have probably spent more time at home lately than we want to. Now, you know, a lot of people have gotten out for work and eating out and whatnot like that, but even so, people are spending more time at home. At least in my neighborhood, I think they're trying to make their homes better. Every week when the bulk trash pickup comes, you know, there's always pieces of furniture and stuff out on the front, you know, to take away. And I've seen repairmen and all kinds of folk around, and I think people are trying to make their homes nicer as they have to stay in. I don't know how many garage sales I've seen in the past 2 weeks. Have you seen that? Kind of amazing. Be that as it may, Jesus is talking about a totally different kind of home when he says, if you make my word your home. And interestingly, Jesus, after he left Nazareth, never had a home. He even said at one point, you know, foxes have their hole, birds have their nest, the Son of Man has no place to lay his head. So Jesus hung out with other people. Obviously, he had a place to sleep and all that kind of stuff, but he had no permanent home. So when he says, make the word your home, he's talking about making yourself at home in that word of God. You know, we talk about people being in their element, you know, in their comfort zone. I think that that's where we want to be with God and his word. We want that to be our comfort zone. We want that to be our element. We want following Jesus to be the sweet spot of our lives. Now, so Jesus is saying, if you make your home in my word, if you abide in my word, if you continue in my word, you are truly my disciples. But recall, this is the gospel of John, where the very first chapter, when it talks about the word, makes it a capital W. The word became flesh and dwelt among us. It's talking about Jesus, not just a book, although the Bible, you know, points us to Jesus, but Jesus is the very word of God, God's ultimate communication. So not just being at home in the Bible, it's being at home in Jesus, thinking like he thinks, acting like he acts, caring like he cares, loving like he does. I'm sure you guys remember the old armbands, WWJD, what would Jesus do? And that had its place and its time. For our purposes, the question is, what am I going to do as a disciple of Jesus? I can't be Jesus, but I can imitate Jesus. I can be the hands and feet of Jesus to our world. So making our home in Jesus and his word is a big part of how we live out our lives as disciples. So we are disciples every single day. And what does it mean to continue in the word of God as his disciples? It may mean that you read your Bible every day. That's a good thing to do. It may be that you pray every day. It's maybe that you meditate or contemplate God every day. It may be you get out and do something to help somebody. You know, everybody's personal pattern of devotion, of love for God, manifests itself in different ways, but Jesus is always at the center. So, if you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth. Truth is kind of a sticky word today. It seems to me that a lot of people have different versions of the truth. I told you before about something called the confirmation bias, and this has nothing to do with what we teach our young people about teachings of the church. Confirmation bias means that for many people, any piece of news, truth, that they hear that confirms what they already believe is something they are going to latch onto. People don't want to be challenged or made uncomfortable. I really think that's why we have a lot of problems in our world today as we politically try to talk to each other. So this week and every week until this first Tuesday in November, we're going to be praying for our country and for the elections. That's what we Christians can certainly do. But I just want you to know in the scriptures, truth is a lot deeper than the facts you might see in the newspaper or on the news or on your internet. For the Greeks who lived in Jesus' day, that's kind of what truth was. It was a body of knowledge. You know, they were some of the first scientists. For the Hebrews, for the Jews, though, truth was more about character, about who you were, about integrity. And for the Jews, the Torah, the holy scriptures of God, spoke of that kind of truth. Jesus takes it a step further because he says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. For we who follow Jesus, truth is a person. That person is Jesus. It's interesting that at the beginning of this text, it's one of those throwaway lines, to the Jews who believed in him, is the way the text begins. And I'm going, wait, they believed in him? And yet if you read the text on in John 8, there's this huge altercation. They're ready to pick up and stone him. What's that all about? It's really that there are two kinds of belief in the Bible, in life, really. There's a belief in the facts. So the Jews who believed in Jesus believed that, oh, okay, he's here. He's done miracles. Those are actually true things. I've seen them. And, you know, that's as far as it goes. But in Greek, there's a word for believe that's followed by the preposition into. You believe into. And what that means is trust and reliance and giving your life over. You know, it's not just I assent to these facts or these propositions. It's I trust this Jesus, the very truth, with my life. So that's the truth here in John chapter 8. Because to know truth is to know Jesus. As you continue in his word and follow him and trust in him. Now, I will say that believing in Jesus as the truth does lead us to other truths, like, for example, it is better to give than to receive, and love your enemies, even though the world doesn't say we should really do that, and that, you know, helping the neighbor is the way we act. So there are a lot of truths we hold that come from believing in Jesus as the truth. And then Jesus says, you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. Another one of those words we define in various ways. The people in Jesus' day were not politically free. A Roman occupying army had taken over their country, but they felt in their hearts they were free. God had made them free. there are people today whose definition of freedom is that means I get to do whatever I want to do anytime I want to do it. And that, I will say, is a very selfish kind of freedom. You know, that kind of freedom, whether we know it or not, is really slavery. To be under the illusion that if you get your own way all the time, that's going to be the best thing ever. We who follow Jesus, we know that that is not true. And Jesus says it. Anyone who is a sinner is a slave to sin. Now, we're all sinners. We know that. But I think what Jesus was really saying was a person who is devoted to sin. Sin is their master and their Lord. It's the sin of those who assert that their own will and their own pride and their own self-centeredness is what's most important, and that makes them slaves. Only love of God can free us from such slavery. Because believe it or not, a life that is fettered to your own will, I want what I want when I want it, is utmost slavery. A slave to your passions, a slave to your desires, a slave in the worst way. And all of us participate that in some way or another. It is from this that Jesus sets us free. It's Reformation Sunday. I have to say something about Martin Luther. You know? Hey, we're Lutherans. Luther felt very much a slave in his life. He had a government of monarchs and the Elector Frederick of Saxony, like all people did in his days. But what he felt a slave to was his own. What can I say? He felt that every sin he committed had to be made up in some way with God by some good action that he did. That's what he was taught. And he would confess his sins until he was blue in the face, and he would try to do the things that his confessor would say, well, do this, you know, to cover up for that. And he just felt helpless and enslaved in misery until he read about grace and said that it is God's grace that frees me from that. Jesus has fulfilled those demands for me. I don't have to do it. Jesus is the one who has taken the burden of my sin. I don't have to be burdened with that. So it's a very freeing thing. And one of the things we celebrate in the Reformation is that freedom that had always been there in the Scriptures, but Luther kind of rediscovered in many ways and shared it with people. There is something paradoxical about our freedom in Christ. There is a wonderful song that goes, make me a captive, Lord, for then I will be free. And there's a great poem by John Donne, if you've ever heard of that guy. It's called Batter My Heart, Three-Personed God. Look it up on the internet when you get home. And in the last part of this poem, he says this of God. Imprison me, for I, except you enthrall me, never shall be free. St. Paul, when he begins all his letters, says, Paul, a servant of Christ. Do you know the word for servant? Doulos is the same word that's used for slave. We could have just as easily translated all those sections from the Bible, Paul, a slave for Christ. The paradox is that is being enslaved to the one who has our utmost good in mind, who loves us with an everlasting love, who grieves when we fall and fail. It is in that that we try and true freedom. So unless we are captive to Christ, we cannot be free. Because if we're not captive of Christ, we're captive to all our sinful desires and everything else. By trusting the one who sacrificed everything for us, we find true freedom. There's an old prayer that begins, O Lord, in whose service is perfect freedom. It is a paradox. The truth is most often hidden in paradox. In Jesus, who is the truth, we are really free. And we are free to be what God made us to be. And in the freedom of the gospel, in the freedom of the love for Jesus, we are most free to be the people that God made us to be, living out our lives as little Christ to all the world and for all the world to see. May God grant that for Jesus' sake. Amen. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. I'm going to ask you to stand. As So one of the things we often do on Reformation Sunday is use some of the words that Luther wrote in the Small Catechism, and today we're going to read his definition of the second article of the Creed, which we'll speak together. And in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. What does this mean? I believe that Jesus Christ, true God, begotten of the Father from eternity, and also true man, born of the Virgin Mary, is my Lord, who has redeemed me, a lost and condemned person, purchased and won me from all sins, from death, and the power of the devil, not with gold or silver, but with his holy, precious blood, and with his innocent suffering and death, that I may be his own, and live under him in his kingdom, and serve him in everlasting righteousness, innocence, and blessedness. Just as he is risen from the dead, lives and reigns to all eternity. This is most certainly true. This time we'd normally, I was going to tell you to be seated, but that's because normally we take the offering, but the offerings are taken at the rear now as you come in. And again, if you haven't turned in your commitment form for the next year, please do that. And the words of Jesus, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also, always apply. But right now, let's go to the Lord in prayer. We praise you, God, our mighty fortress. We thank you, Jesus, for setting us free and for being the truth. We ask you, Holy Spirit, to help us to continue to abide in your word. We pray for the suffering, especially naming Larry Sparks, Bob Andrus, Risa Hedge, Harrison Perez, Cindy Stewart, and others we name in our heart that you grant healing. We pray for all who receive Holy Communion, that it grant pardon, peace, and strength and love for you and others. As the weeks and months of this pandemic continue, we pray for those suffering from the virus, that you grant healing, for those caring for them, that you grant patience, for those isolated, that you grant strength and companionship, for those financially suffering, that you provide help, for our neighbors and friends to be wise and careful for the sake of others, and for our leaders in our city, state, country, and church, that you give wisdom, strength, and humility. The vaccine be developed, a cure found, and in all things, Lord, decrease the sense of anxiety and stress that affects all of us. We pray for our country as elections approach, that you grant wisdom to those who cast their votes, that your will be done. We pray for the stewardship of our time, talent, and treasure, that we use your gifts to serve you, and that we give to you, God, the things that are already yours. We pray for the ministry and mission of Bethel, that our plans for the coming months and years would be in line with your will, and that our worship, care, service, and growth would be blessed by you. Lord God, you are a mighty fortress, a very present help in time of trouble. Preserve your people and our nation from a sense of false security, lest we place our trust and hope in anyone or anything but you. We pray all this in the name of Jesus. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give him thanks and praise. It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should, at all times and in all places, give thanks to you, O Lord, our King, our God, King of all creation, for you have had mercy on us and given your only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. Grant us your Spirit, gracious Father, that we may give heed to the testament of your Son in true faith, And above all, firmly take to heart the words which with Christ gives to us his body and blood for our forgiveness. By your grace, lead us to remember and give thanks for the boundless love which he manifested to us when, by pouring out his precious blood, he saved us from sin, death, and the devil. Grant that we may receive the bread and the wine, that is, his body and blood, as a gift, guarantee, and pledge of his salvation. Graciously receive our prayers. Deliver and preserve us. To you alone, O Father, be all glory, honor, and worship, with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever, as we join with angels and archangels and all the host of heaven in praising you as we sing. Holy, 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 Lord, God of heaven, my heaven and earth, all full of your glory. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, the same night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen. You may be seated. So you may have noticed things look different on the altar today. So we are today giving you the option of coming forward to receive the sacrament. Now, you can do the same as we've done for the past many weeks, which is, you know, in the pew racks, there is the little bread and wine, and there's an explanation on the board on how to do that way. If that feels safest for you, by all means, that's great. Otherwise, we have Ronnie and Steve here, and the way this is going to work is they're going to be standing right here. Actually, I'm going to be standing on the other side. Come forward as families if you desire to do so. Try to keep 6 feet distance between the family that is in front of you. We will drop the wafer into your hand, and we will place the individual cup into your hand, so there should be no touching of any of these things, so we feel safe. We're wearing gloves. I'm going to put my mask back on. These guys have their masks on. And then we're asking you at this time not to kneel at the rail, but just to circle back around. There are baskets on either side that you can drop the empty cup into. So what this means is when you come forward, and there's hand sanitizer there if you want to use it, when you come forward, hold out your hand. You can take down your mask for that time of receiving the bread and wine, and then go back to your seats. We pray that this is salutary and good for us. And so I'm going to say welcome to the table of the Lord.
Also, if someone in the congregation wants to have alcohol free, we've got it. So if you'll just let Ron know, and we'll make sure that you can let it alcohol free. So.
Thanks, Steve. The blood of Christ. 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 In that basket, the blood of Christ, the blood of Christ, the blood of Christ, the blood of Christ. Blood of Christ. The blood of Christ. The blood of Christ. Now may this, the body and blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, give you strength, preserve you in true faith, and to life everlasting, go in peace. We stand for prayer. Gracious God, our Heavenly Father, you have given us a foretaste of the feast to come and the Holy Supper of your Son's body and blood. Keep us firm in the true faith throughout the days of our pilgrimage, that on the day of his coming, we may, together with all the saints, celebrate the marriage feast of the Lamb and his kingdom, which has no end, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. We sing the closing hymn, The Church's One Foundation. Please be seated. I'm going to invite Sarah Hutchings, our president, forward right now for a communication update. It's a week early because she's going to be out of town next week, but she wanted to share with you some things going on at the church. And I'll just say, hey, that worked out great. Well done by you guys. Phase by phase, getting back. But I appreciate your patience and the way you handled that. Well done. All right, Sarah.
Good morning. It's good to be worshiping together in person and online. Natalie Harris has coordinated the technology and editing skills to record live services with quality sound. We will continue to offer online worship and to enhance our online presence even after COVID. This week, Bethel was rewired for internet access, which will move us toward live streaming, not yet, but hopefully in the future. Bethel, as one congregation, is blessed to have four services every Sunday, two in English, one in Spanish, and one in Kenyan-Yarwandan. 2021 will be an exciting year of transition at Bethel. Pastor Randy will retire in July, and a party to celebrate his years of faithful service will be planned for this summer. The ministry plan for 2021 includes an emphasis on children and youth. We plan to apply for a DCE intern through Concordia University of Texas in January to begin service the summer of 2021. We also want to grow our relationship with the children in the ELC and community partners such as Highland Meadows Elementary School. Bethel will recruit and train leaders to start new growth groups to meet at church, in homes, and via Zoom. Pastor Joseph, a deacon of the LCMS, and Jonas, who attends the fourth service and is a member of the church council, will begin attending seminary next year. Pastor Randy will serve as their mentor through the process. Pastor Johannes is setting up a group with one other person, Absalom, to form a team as they go through seminary together. This support system will enhance their experience as they grow and prepare to become ordained LCMS pastors. The transition team is beginning to work on the process to select a new pastor for Bethel, and we want your input. The transition team will send out a survey soon to find the qualities that the congregation desires in the next senior pastor. Please submit the survey when it comes out so that your voice can be heard. A search committee will be put together to continue the process. Pastor Chris will serve as the interim pastor and mentor the DCE intern. This will ensure continuity with our current ministries during the transition period. We have been participating in our annual stewardship drive this month. This is an opportunity for all of us to make a commitment to give our time, talent, and treasures during the coming year. Is a wonderful time to assess what we are giving back to God. If you haven't already, I encourage you to joyfully submit your commitment card this week. You can do it by turning in the card in the narthex, mailing it in, or submitting your pledge online through the Bethel website. This helps the church council plan how to use the blessings that we have received in the coming year. The goal is to complete the 2021 budget by October 28th. There are lots of ways to serve as we go to make disciples of all people. I encourage you to contact a member that you haven't seen recently and to contact someone in your community. It's a chance to be a blessing in their lives. The Belize Mission Society serves the village of St. Bite. Last year, 10 short-term teams were able to serve in the village. During the pandemic, they have been able to continue the feeding program and education scholarships. They have created a Facebook page. Every morning, someone from the group does a live devotion. For more information about this ministry, please contact Gail Winningham. Also, check the Bethel at a Glance to find other ways to serve our community. I want to give a special thanks to Steve Silhanek, who has served as the financial secretary at Bethel for more than 15 years. Richard Simpson has agreed to take on this responsibility. Members of the LWML have prepared materials for Lutheran World Relief. The in-gathering will be on Saturday, November 14th. A group of about 12 quilters meet at Peace Lutheran Church at 10:30 every Friday to make quilts. After quilting, they eat lunch together for fellowship, laughter, and to support each other in prayer. They have boxed up 158 quilts for overseas missions. Contact Ona Cook if you are interested in joining this group. Other LWML groups have prepared 20 school kits, 45 personal care kits, and 6 sewing kits. The annual voters assembly will be Sunday, November 15th. You can attend in person or via Zoom. We will use the polling option in Zoom so that people attending online can vote anonymously. Please contact the church office if you need help in being able to participate in a Zoom meeting. Please pray for guidance as Bethel prepares opportunities for worship, caring, serving, and discipleship in the coming year. God has placed Bethel in this place to be a light in the community. Together we can serve the Lord with gladness. Thank you.